Today we're going to try to save reality. Or at least save realism. Actually, just local realism. However, this rescue effort has a price, and one that you may not be willing to pay. According to some, your free will is at stake. On its most elementary scale, the universe exists in a state of fundamental indeterminacy. Photons passing through two slits at once, electrons being spin up and spin down, cats being both alive and dead. These quantum superpositions only collapse into single states when we try to measure them. It's almost as though the physical properties of the objects don't reside in the objects themselves, but emerge as a consequence of our observations. Some physicists and philosophers have wondered if reality is fundamentally subjective, whether it exists primarily as a consequence of the act of observation. Others, perhaps most, prefer to think of the universe as having a concrete existence independent of the observer. We call that view realism. There have been many efforts to find realist interpretations of quantum mechanics. Pilot wave theory, objective collapse models, even the many worlds interpretation all seek to describe a reality that exists sans observers. But there is one reality life draft that we haven't touched on this show, and that's superdeterminism. It may have the most disturbing implications of all. Erwin Schrödinger, co-inventor of quantum mechanics with Werner Heisenberg, was a big proponent of realism. In fact, his alive and dead feline thought experiment was a reductio ad absurdum designed to highlight the ridiculousness of extrapolating observer-dependent indeterminacy to large or macroscopic objects. Albert Einstein also came up with a scenario in which he tried to refute the non-realist implications of pure quantum mechanics. Along with Boris Podolsky and Nathan Rosen, he proposed the Epr Paradox, which was meant to deal a swift death blow to this observer-centric nonsense. We've talked about the Epr Paradox before, but it's really worth a second look, especially given the stakes. In standard quantum mechanics, the fundamental building block of reality is the wave function. It describes the evolving probability distribution of all possible properties of the world, or of tiny parts of the world. The results of your measurements are plucked from the wave function of whatever you're observing. We say that measurement collapses the wave function, obliterating all potential results in favor of one actual result. A wave function could span multiple distinct, even contradictory states. For example, an electron can be spinning in two different directions simultaneously. This is quantum superposition. And a wave function can also span multiple particles, holding information about the relationships between those particles. This is quantum entanglement. Let's say we have a pair of electrons, each in a superposition of spin states, say with spin axis simultaneously pointing up and down. But the electrons could also be entangled with each other so that their spins are guaranteed to be opposite to each other, even if they aren't defined individually. Measurement of one electron would influence the other in a very real way, something Einstein referred to as spooky action at a distance. Standard quantum mechanics says that this is possible, but it leads to the seemingly absurd result of the Epr paradox. Let's see how it plays out. We prepare a pair of entangled electrons. Their spin direction is undefined. All we know is that they are opposite to each other. We give one electron to Alice and one to Bob, who then both go back to their separate labs to measure the spin. According to standard quantum mechanics, that spin is undefined until measurement. Upon measurement, it'll become fixed along the axis of the measurement device. Let's say Alice uses a vertical orientation. She'll measure the spin as being either up or down, with a 50-50 chance of each. Say she measures spin up. But that means we know what Bob's electron's spin must be. It must be down, even before he measures it. If Bob then chooses to measure using the same vertical orientation, he'll definitely measure spin down, but he could choose a different orientation. A horizontal measurement yields a 50-50 chance of being left or right for this down-pointing electron. But any other choice will actually be influenced by Alice's original choice of measuring orientation. When the scientists come back together to compare results, they'll notice a certain peculiar correlation between their choices of measurement axis and the other's measured spin. And it doesn't matter how far apart Alice and Bob's labs are across the campus or across the galaxy, the apparent influence should be instantaneous. This is the type of effect that made Einstein and company so uncomfortable. A foundational axiom of relativity is that no causal influence can travel faster than the speed of light. The Epr paradox was meant to show that this sort of undefinedness couldn't be the underlying reality because it violates the cosmic speed limit. He thought that each electron had to carry all of the information about its own physical state in a way that was somehow hidden from the wave function of standard quantum mechanics. We can imagine the same scenario in the case where the electrons do know their own spin all along. In that case, the spins are set at the beginning, still opposite to each other, but defined. Even if Alice and Bob don't know what they are just yet. The scientists go off and make their own choices for their measurement directions, but now nothing that Alice can do will change Bob's results. When the two compare results, they will see correlations between the spin measurements because the original spin directions were correlated, but there's no correlation between one scientist's measurement results and the other scientist's choice of measurement direction. It wasn't until 1960, nearly 30 years after the Epr paradox paper was published, that physicist John Bell gave us a concrete test for all of this. He derived a mathematical statement, the Bell inequality, that is true in the case that the electron spins are set from the beginning and contained within the electron, but false if standard quantum mechanics is right and spin is undefined until observation. And it took another 20 years for the first Bell test to be successfully performed by Alain Aspect. That test thoroughly supported standard quantum mechanics. Countless Bell-type tests have been performed since, all with the same result. Apparently, entanglement is real, and it's as spooky as Einstein feared. But actually, the results of the Bell tests are not convincing evidence against realism itself. The world may still have a non-subjective existence. According to the Bell theorem, any local realist theory must obey the Bell inequality. So, a violation of the inequality could be a violation of realism or of locality. Or, sure, of both. In a local realist theory, every point in space and time, every event, can only be influenced by a space-time event in its causal past, so near enough to have sent a signal. There are ways to save realism in quantum mechanics by crossing Einstein and abandoning this locality. Things like pilot wave theory and objective collapse models try to do that. On the other hand, the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics saves local realism at the cost of requiring multiple realities. If that price is too high for you, there may be another way. But I'm not sure you're going to like it any better. Let's play out the Bell test on something called a space-time diagram, with one dimension of space along the x-axis and time on the y. Alice and Bob start out together, acquire their entangled electrons, and then move sideways in space and up in time. Light travels a 45 degree angle, and so if local realism holds, only events in what we call the past light cone of, say, Bob's location should have been able to influence whatever happens at his position. But quantum mechanics says that when Alice measures her electron, Bob's electron is instantly affected. That violates local realism. Now let's look at the case where the electrons start out with defined spins. It's no surprise that Alice and Bob observe opposite spins because we can see that both electron spins were determined by a single event in both of their past light cones. Alice and Bob may observe correlated information if there's a causal path to both of them. But here's where we find our loophole. The Bell test results are weird because Bob's measurements turn out to be inexplicably correlated with Alice's choices. But that's only weird if Alice's choices themselves are independent events defined wholly in the present moment. Locality and realism would have been saved if it had turned out that the states of the electrons were fixed when their past light cones overlapped. But what if, instead, the future decisions of Alice and Bob are influenced within that same past overlap? In Bell's theorem, his inequality is satisfied in local realist theories. But there is another condition to the validity of the theorem. That's the statistical independence of the measurements. It assumes that Alice and Bob can choose with absolute freedom, or that if they choose randomly, that their random number generator is perfect. But what if statistical independence is an idealization? Trace past light cones back far enough and everything is connected. What if those connections produce sufficient correlations between Alice and Bob's supposedly free decision for how they'll make their measurements and the states of the measured particles? It may still be possible to violate Bell's inequality without saying anything about local realism. This way out of the Epr paradox is called superdeterminism. Superdeterminism is, well, it's just determinism, the statement that the universe and any system therein evolves in a way that's uniquely predictable by the laws of physics and its initial state. Determinism on its own doesn't guarantee the sort of uncanny convergence in that evolution needed to solve the Epr paradox. That's what the super part is for. Some have argued that superdeterminism requires a kind of conspiracy of interactions to ensure that two messy meat computers make the right choices based on marginal interactions arbitrarily far in the past. Others, like Sabina Hossenfelder, argue that superdeterminism is actually the cleanest solution to the Epr paradox, and you can watch her video on that to decide for yourself. Regardless of its plausibility, superdeterminism is a loophole in the Bell theorem that physicists have tried to test. To close the loophole, a Bell test needs to be performed where the choice of measurement direction is truly statistically independent. And that's impossible, because if you trace the past light cone of any two points in the observable universe back far enough, they will overlap. Everything has a past causal connection with everything else. But we can at least do a Bell test where the deciders and the measurement subjects have past light cones that intersect with each other as far back in the past as possible. And so I'd like to introduce you to the cosmic Bell test. This was performed by Anton Zeilinger's group at the University of Vienna in 2017. Their first effort used the light from a pair of distant stars as proxies for Alice and Bob. The random color of individual photons of that light was used in place of a random number generator to decide the measurement orientation in the Bell test. Now, this experiment used the polarization direction of photons rather than the spin direction of electrons, but it's the same deal. They observed violations in Bell's inequality with extremely high significance, which they claim ensures that no local realist influences could have messed with Alice and Bob's decision, except in the seemingly implausible scenario of the stars talking to each other and conspiring against us. The same team followed up with a cosmic Bell test using rather more distant objects, quasars several billion light years away, that pushed back any possible local realist influence more than half the age of the universe. Theorists are still debating how to interpret superdeterminism, although the majority seem to be on Anton Zeilinger's side in dismissing it. Sabina is an emphatic voice on the opposing side. Let's stay neutral just for the moment and look at what we know. The many Bell tests, cosmic and regular, tell us that either locality or realism are wrong, or that there are multiple realities, or the universe evolves in unalterable lockstep determinism in a way that preserves correlations between measurement, subject, and measurer. The latter has philosophical implications for our own dreams of being detached observers independent of our subjects. But you know what? Quantum mechanics has been telling us that we are not that for 100 years. As for the question of free will, look, when philosophers come up with a reasonable definition of the thing, maybe we can talk. But think of it this way. Your mind has a physical substrate, your brain. Your mind isn't an illusion just because it's an emergent phenomenon. If your choices have a physical, even deterministic substrate, that doesn't change the fact that right now you know that you can choose whether or not to believe in a superdeterministic spacetime. Hey, thanks for clicking that play button. Those views are actually really important for us. Now, if you think that this show is good enough to deserve even more than one click, you might consider trying out some of those other buttons down there. The like one is really good, and the subscribe button is amazing, certainly for us. Crazily, those buttons require exactly the same motor force from your finger as it took to watch this video. It's a great deal. Now, for those of you who think you could spare several more clicks, and perhaps even a buck or two, you'll find a Patreon link in the description. Now, today I want to give a special thanks to Adam Hillier, who's supporting us on Patreon at the Big Bang level. Adam, I don't know whether the universe is superdeterministic on its deepest level, but it sure seems pretty uncertain up here. And that's especially true when it comes to planning the future of a YouTube show. So thank you for bringing us a step closer to fiscal superdeterminism so that the overlap of our past light cones can remain as recent as possible. In our last episode, we talked about the challenges of decoding alien physics due to the hidden conventions that have been chosen arbitrarily in order to break the underlying symmetries of nature. Agnido Dutta asks if there's any symmetry in physics which holds for transformations in the color charge. For example, do different color quarks decay in the same way? Well, actually, yes, they do decay exactly the same, besides influencing the color charge of their decay products. The symmetry in question is the strong force symmetry, known as the special unitary group of order 3, or just SU3. It's quite complex, so quick analogies are impossible, but we're working towards some episodes on it, so hold tight. Olivier van Cantfort points out that a bigger problem than these conventions might just be the units that the aliens are using. Probably no such thing as centimeters or becquerels on TRAPPIST-1C. Fortunately, units are actually a bit easier to communicate. There are certain fundamental lengths, distances, energies, etc., that aliens could use to translate their units, for example, Planck units, or the energies or masses or decay timescales of common particles and elements. On that note, Dandelion Stitches points out that the problem with electric charge sign convention could be resolved by including a list of common elements. Now, that's true. If the alien simply described the hydrogen atom and we saw that its electron had positive charge, we'd be set. Dai Lixiuan and Mr. Overpair points out that we'd be able to tell what time direction the aliens use by their laws of thermodynamics. That's absolutely right, and we should have included that. The second law of thermodynamics says entropy must increase in the forward time direction. Their expression for the second law would tell us what sign convention they use for time. The fact is, these aliens would have had to have actually tried in order to avoid revealing their physics conventions. Any basic description of the universe they live in beyond the actual laws of physics themselves would reveal that. That's why the scenario I outlined was not the actual point of the video, rather it was a nefarious trick to teach you about hidden conventions and symmetries. Because, as Benjamin Heasley points out, aliens would surely give some tests that we could run to not risk planetary destruction. The fact that their designs are cataclysmic if assembled incorrectly could then be deliberate. What better test for fitness to join the galactic civilization than making sure a new species is smart enough to check basic conventions in an instruction manual? No Star Trek future unless you can assemble furniture without destroying your planet.